I just wanted to pop in on this, what for me is a Sunday evening, but it could be Monday morning if you're on the other side of the world, or maybe you're watching later, so it could be any time at all. I just wanted to pop in spontaneously and say hey, because a lot of things have been going on for me, and I've been really excited about everything. And I just have been missing all of you, missing coming online live and saying hi to all of you. And I want to take your questions. And so I wanted to just tell you something about my weekend so far. It's been an amazing weekend. And last night, Danny and I both spent the night at a wonderful friend's house here in LA. We're in Los Angeles. We spent the night at Kelly Lang's house. And this morning she took us to her Unity Church. She goes to this amazing Unity Church where they speak about how we are all one. It doesn't matter what religion you are, we all come together, we're all one. And it was really beautiful. And I didn't realize when I went there that many of the people who attend that church had read my book. So they recognized me, which was fun. And then the reverend, the person who was actually on stage leading the sermon and everything, he surprised me and he called me onto the stage. And then he briefly told the audience my story about how I had cancer and how I had died, and when I came back, my body healed. And so then he said to me, so I'd like you to tell the audience, how do they live heaven on earth? Because in your book, you said you came back when you realized heaven is a state of being and not a place. And so you came back when you realized that, and so you brought that piece of heaven with you. So how do you live heaven on earth? And I thought, wow, that's a pretty small question, or a pretty big question to catch me on the spot with. So the first answer I came up with, I thought, okay, how do you live heaven on earth in 30 seconds? Eat chocolate every day. That was the first answer I came up with. Then I thought, okay, let me give the audience a little bit more. So I started to explain to them about what I actually wrote a little bit about in my first book and a little more about in my second book. And I thought it would be a good idea to mention that here today, just as a reminder to people, or even for myself, because I love talking about this. When I was in that realm, I understood that the reason I had been really suffering up to that point was because I not only did not love myself, I'd never loved myself, I'd always treated myself like a doormat, I'd always been a people pleaser, but by doing all those things, I had what I now call an outside-in view of life. And what I mean by that is that I took everything in the outside world seriously, what people thought of me, or what was going on in the world, or the news, or social media, or whatever. The outside world was the real world, and the inner me contorted itself to accommodate to the outside world. Not only did the inner me contort itself, I bent myself out of shape like a pretzel to please other people, but I would also get stressed if I disappointed people. I would get stressed by external events, bad things happening in the world. So the outside world to me was the real world, and the inner world was not the real world, but was always reacting to the outside world. When I was in the coma and when I crossed the veil and I was in the other realm, I understood that actually the inner world is the real world. And if I am at peace, if I love myself, if I am the one that embraces myself and who I am and remains calm and shares love and is loving and recognizes that I am love, I am God. If I am at a good place, then the world around me will reflect that back to me. And so what happens is when we have this inside out view of the world, when we realize our inner world is the real world, we end up creating life rather than reacting to life. And I'm sensing that we need to do that more and more today, because social media and the mass media, like the news and all this stuff that's going on in the world, has everybody going crazy. And here's what happens. When we react to everything that's going on outside, And when it's making us angry and it's making us stressed, that is the person we're taking with us wherever we go. That is what we're spreading. And then what we're doing is we're triggering it in other people. But when we realize that the most important thing is our inner state, we then focus on getting to a place internally where we realize that we are love. We are the creators of our lives. Instead of being reacting to our lives, we create our lives. So when we start to realize that and we work on ourselves, then what happens is that the person we take out into the world is one of calm and peace and love. But not only that, the world then that we see reflected back to us is the one that we've created internally. And that's how I've managed to create a life of heaven on earth. And every now and then, when I forget, when I start to feel guilty, when people drag me, when I start to lose sight of that, and I start to feel stressed about things that are happening outside, what happens is that what I'm feeling inside starts to then feed the outside world, and the outside feeds it back to me. In other words, when I forget and I start to get stressed about what's happening in the world, I then take on that stress and I create more stressful situations. And then I go in this downward spiral, and then I have to remind myself, no, wait, it's not about changing the world. It's not about getting stressed with what's happening outside. It's about finding my center, calming myself. It's about loving myself. It's about realizing that I am an expression of God. It's not about, why is God doing this? Why did God do this? It's about, if I am God, what would I do? How would I change the world? It's about finding that God source within me. And once I realize that, and all of us are expressions of God, not me, I'm not special, I'm just an ordinary person that had something extraordinary happen to me, but all of us have this capacity to find the God within us. And when we find that, then the external world reflects back to us what we are inside. I want to add here that on my third book, I'm actually writing my third book, and I am going to be writing a lot more about that, a lot more about the comparison between how I used to live my life before and how I live now, and how just by changing our inner world, we can change the whole world. And I'm going to go deeply into that. And I'm also going to talk about how I used to be a doormat. And the working title at the moment is Confessions of a Recovering Doormat, but it depends on the publishers whether they accept it. And the most exciting thing is that I have a brand new publisher, which I'm really excited about. They are Simon & Schuster. They loved the idea of my proposal and my new book, and so they've picked up proposal, and they're going to be publishing my third book. So I'm really excited about that. I would love to take some of your questions now. And I also wanted to just let you know that my beautiful friend Angie DeMuro and myself, we had partnered up to do this children's book. And one of the driving forces for me to have a children's book put out is because I wanted kids to know what I didn't know as a child. What I believe that if I knew would have prevented me from getting cancer. And I truly believe that if I knew that I was love and that I was loved, even when I was bullied, that I was still loved, if I knew that, I really believe I would not have got cancer. Which is why I'm so grateful to Angie DeMuro for partnering up with me and putting this together, because she used many of the words and the concepts that I shared in my first book, Dying to Be Me, and she put it into kids' language and drew these adorable illustrations. And I want to say I'm really grateful for those of you who've ordered it, read it, and given us such amazing reviews. So thank you, all of you, for that. And the ones of you who've sent me photos, and I really appreciate it. Your kids are just so cute, and even the fur babies. Some of your kids are reading the book out to your fur babies, and that is so cute.
Someone is asking where the book is available, so I just thought I'd mention it's on Amazon in the U.S., U.K., Amazon Global, and Amazon Canada as of right now.
Great, yes. So it's on Amazon at the moment, and you can order it. And We are trying to get, so I want to say here that we self-published it. We were flying by the seat of our pants. We wanted to get this out really quickly because we felt it's the time. The time is now. There's no other time like the present. So we just self-published it. So it isn't available yet all over the world. It isn't available in all the foreign languages, but we have received inquiries from different publishers and different publishers around the world. So we are working with them because we do want it to be in different languages, and we are looking to get it distributed all over the world. But give us time. It isn't available all over the world yet. So thanks for your patience.
Adrian asks, how do you create the balance between connecting with the love and metaphysical nature, spirituality, and being there to create a loving relationship with diverse social dimensions, like showing up for people who are being systematically oppressed?
And that's a good question. And I, so when you show up for people who are in any situation, in your case, you say systematically oppressed, but when you show up for people who have any kind of issues, it's really important that you show up from a space of being connected yourself. Because if we don't take care of ourselves, if we don't take care of our souls and our emotional health, spiritual health, then we are bringing a broken self into their lives. And very often we try to fix people from a space of being broken ourselves. When you fix yourself, not saying that you need to be fixed, but when we, so let's not say fix, when we are aware of our own inner light, our own love, all we need to do is shine our light bright in the presence of others, including somebody who is oppressed or has any other issues. We don't even need to actually help them or tell ourselves we're helping them, simply because I don't believe anybody needs help in that sense. I think everybody is perfect where they are. But just by being the brightest light that you can be, you will elevate those around you without even trying to elevate them. I truly believe that's the best thing any of us can do for anybody. And even with parents having issues with children, the biggest thing you can do is bring a fully loving, brightly lit, self-actualized self to your child, and your very presence will change them.
That's great. You answered someone else's question about parenting, you know, how to parent instead of being guilty, and you just answered it. So let me real quick find another one.
And I just want to add, with parenting, the best thing we can do is just love our children. Forget about teaching our children. They're here for us to love them, and just love them and be a role model of what you would like them to see, but don't worry about the words that come out of your mouth. Just be a presence of love. That's it.
Jessica asks, if you're in a good place but you run into an abusive, negative person, is that necessarily due to your inner world?
Absolutely not. Do not take responsibility or feel guilty or start to change yourself and believe, what have I done to attract that? You didn't do anything. Sometimes when we're in a good place, we become a magnet for people who are struggling or in a negative place because they want what we have. So remember that. So your job is to hold on to the good place you're at and don't compromise yourself. Don't feel you need to dim your light if other people around you are finding you to be too bright, too positive, too successful, too abundant. There will be people, even well-meaning people, who love you but will possibly bring you down, not inadvertently. They're not, I don't like to use the term toxic people because I don't think anybody deliberately tries to be toxic. Everybody has the intention of being a good person, an uplifting person. But there's only two kinds of people, the ones who know that we are an expression of God and the ones who don't. That's it. But every single one of us are an expression of God. It's just that some know it and some don't. And that's the only difference. So if you look at everybody as an expression of God, and they may not know it, but you treat them as though they are, you will bring out the best in them.
Amy asks, how does one transcend the trauma of being raised by a clinical psychopath? she tries to be at peace, but she seems to attract these very disconnected people.
Oh, so I, first of all, I'm really sorry you had to go through that. And you do need to spend some time alone and really, really care for yourself at a deep level. If you feel that you need help, please, please go and get help. But I just want to say that the kind of help I would like you to look for is the kind of help where the people supporting you don't make you feel inadequate or less than, because you are an amazing, complete, beautiful human being. And just some of the, it's just that things have happened to you that have added layers to your beauty. And so that's why you can't see it. It doesn't mean you're broken. You're not broken. You are whole, complete, and beautiful. And you need to know that. You need to be with people who will remind you of that. So even if you get help, work with people who will remind you that you're whole and beautiful. And it's just that you have to drop what is not you. You have to drop the layers that have been added, the filters that you've added to protect yourself from the psychopath. You've added these layers, and now you can feel safe and drop them. You may need time to do that. You may try meditation. You may need to be surrounded by people who will help you. But just remember, whoever you work with, whatever you do, remember one thing: you are not broken. You are absolutely not broken. You are absolutely whole and beautiful in every way.
There are more. I'm sorry. It's just taking me a second.
No,
okay. Ginger asks, what is the best way to diffuse anger and fear in someone who is around us?
So if it's impossible to diffuse anger and fear in someone who's around you, the best thing you can do for yourself is just to remove yourself from the situation. It doesn't mean you have, it doesn't make you unloving. It doesn't mean you have to be unloving or not nice towards the person. You can just excuse yourself from the situation. However, if it is someone you love and you don't want to remove yourself and somebody is feeling anger, the best way to actually really diffuse it face to face is to grab their hands, hold them by their hands, and look straight into their eyes. And if it's someone you love or care about, like a partner, a spouse, a child, one of your grown-up children, look into their eyes and you can tell them whatever message that comes into your heart. It can be a message like, I love you, or it can be something like, I'm never leaving you, or whatever it is that comes into your heart. But when you hold somebody's hands, if you grab both their hands, you will always diffuse the anger. And if you can look into their eyes, and if the next step can even be a hug, then when you're holding each other, whatever you feel for each other, it will transcend whatever anger that's there. And you'll find that words don't even need to be spoken, because sometimes we forget that we are more than physical beings. And anger comes from frustration of being trapped sometimes in our paradigm, in our culture, in our physical body, and our spirit or our soul is not able to express or do what it wants to do. But when you hug somebody and your energies overlap, it transcends words, it transcends anger.
Extine asks a pretty big question, but I'm going to throw it to you anyway. Are we headed towards a new era of enlightenment, or do we need to fall much further before that occurs? What's your opinion? Not that you absolutely know that answer, but...
Yes, so I won't claim to absolutely know it, but I'll give my opinion on it. I don't actually think we need to fall much further. My opinion is I don't think we can fall much further than where we are. And I think that what's happening at the moment, I may be being optimistic, but I truly believe that what's happening at the moment is to take us somewhere better than we've ever been before. Because it's like everything that needs to be healed is being brought up to the surface. There is so much that has been going on below the surface, beneath the surface. And it's almost like right now, our shadow side is being brought up. So many of the issues we're facing, you know, whether it's systemic abuse or systemic racism or whatever it is, it's not like it just happened now. It's not like it just happened with the current administration or whatever. It's been going on beneath the surface. And it's being brought up so that we can face our shadow side, and we can, so that we can actually say, this is not who we are. This is not who we are. So we can actually take action to clean it up and really start to be and create who we truly are, which is love. It's pure love. So thank you for that question.
We have time for one more question.
Okay.
Andrea asks, how do you face the fear of upcoming medical tests? She had stage 3 colon cancer 3 years ago, and the next test is coming up soon.
So that's a great question. I am actually, you know, someone who doesn't like the way the current medical system is set up because it is so fear-focused and illness-focused. They send you home and say, come back for the medical test, and our medical system is focused on looking for disease and does nothing to support our health and well-being. That is the conventional medical system or the conventional medical paradigm. So what I would invite you to do is, actually before I go into that, and I wanted to say, even those of us who are focused on health and wellness, we are focused on it from a point of fear of illness, and therefore I must focus on eating healthy food. I must focus on not getting cancer again. I was the person who was obsessed with not getting cancer. I used to eat healthy food because I really didn't want to get cancer. I used to take all the supplements because I didn't want to get cancer. But I was so focused on not getting cancer that I ended up getting cancer. What I invite you to do, and anyone else who's fearing illness or who's fearing a medical test, I would invite you not to actually think of the illness. Even if you have a medical test coming up, tell yourself, if I have my health for the rest of my life, if I have a clean bill of health, what would I be doing with my life? What would I, so if even if you're dealing with an illness right now, and I want you to imagine if you get a clean bill of health, the doctor tells you that you have a clean bill of health right now, first of all, what would you do to celebrate? And I want you to do that anyway. And then what will you do with the rest of your life knowing that you have a clean bill of health? Because your health is dependent on you living life to the fullest. Your health doesn't need you to focus on your health. Your physical body is smarter than you think. So if you have a medical test coming up, it's not about positive visualization for the medical test to show up positive. It's about not even focusing on the medical test, but on focusing on life and getting excited about life, living your life with passion, and treating things like the medical test that's coming up as just something you have to do. Oh, it's just something on my calendar. But the way to treat it as something on your calendar is to shift your focus. What am I going to do tomorrow that really excites me? What do I want to do with the rest of my life? Because I have a vibrant, healthy life, and I want to spend it doing something that I'm passionate about. I want to follow my purpose. Those are the things we need to focus on, not our health. So thanks for that question.
Do you want to tell them about your upcoming events?
Oh, sure. That's a great idea, Milena. So the event I'm actually really excited about is the cruise. I'm going to be doing a cruise in March, and I would love for you guys to join me. And the link for it is on my website. It's on Facebook, and we will add it on this thread. And why I'm really excited about it is because it's a 7-day cruise. And you know, normally when I give a speech or something, and even if people resonate with what I say, everybody eventually has to go home and they have to go back to their old environment. So I've started developing longer events where I get to spend more time with you guys so that you can get more into the habit of living a different way, living the inside out way. And one of the other things I've noticed with a lot of people who I attract or who are attracted to my message is that you're all very, very good at giving of yourselves. You give and give, but you're not great at receiving. I feel that you need to spend a few days learning to receive abundance if you want to get out into the world and really experience the abundance that the world has for you, it's about getting into the habit and really feeling what abundance is. And what better way to feel abundance than on a cruise? So on this cruise, we get to spend 7 days together talking about all these kinds of things. And we will be able to do sunrise meditations, sunset meditations, being out in the middle of the ocean with great energy, where it feels like the veil is thinner between this realm and that realm, where we'll have more insights. So this is in March, and here's another big treat. I know so many of you love Dr. Joe Dispenza. Well, he's coming as well. So that's a really big bonus. So he and I have created this event to spend 7 days with all of you in the middle of the ocean, and we're calling it Bridging the Mind and the Heart. And the other event, I'm going to be speaking at Goop, Gwyneth Paltrow's event, in January in New York, and I'm really excited about that as well. So if you're ever at any of my events, please come up and say, hey, I'm doing quite a few more events in Europe. So for those of you in Europe, I am coming to Germany and Switzerland in May, and also Croatia and Paris. So please check out my website. I would love to see you. I would love for you to join me. Thank you all. I love you so much. Have a great Thanksgiving week. And don't forget that it's Thanksgiving week. I want you to think of everything that you're thankful for this week. And I'm sure there's a lot. And I'm really thankful to Angie DeMuro for partnering with me on this book. Thank you, everyone. Love you all. Bye.